Last night we had a lovely Ash Wednesday service here at the sanctuary in Riverview. And unfortunately though, we did have some severe technical difficulties which affected our volume and therefore the quality of our service. I'm sure it was very difficult to try to watch it online, and so I apologize to our online viewers. But in light of that, I have decided to re-record some of the service elements from that worship time together. So if you're watching this, this is just a brief synopsis of that time of worship together. And so let us take a moment to center our hearts and our minds for worship with these call to worship words. Turn away from the calls of worldly success. Repent and turn back to God. Turn away from the desire to have what everyone else has. Repent and turn back to God. Turn away from greed and the race for power. Repent and turn back to God. As we enter the season of Lent, may we turn back to God. May we seek forgiveness. May we seek healing. May we seek wholeness. May our hearts be renewed in this time of worship together. Our first scripture reading comes from Psalm 51. Have mercy on me, God, according to your faithful love. Wipe away my wrongdoings according to your great compassion. Wash me completely clean of my guilt. Purify me from my sin. Because I know my wrongdoings, my sin is always right in front of me. I've sinned against you, you alone. I've committed evil in your sight. And that's why you are justified when you render your verdict, completely correct when you issue your judgment. Yes, I was born in guilt, in sin, from the moment my mother conceived me. And yes, you want truth in the most hidden places, and you teach me wisdom in the most secret space. Purify me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and celebration again. And let the bones you crushed rejoice once more. Hide your face from my sins. Wipe away all my guilty deeds. Create a clean heart for me, God. Put a new, faithful spirit deep inside me. Please don't throw me out of your presence. Please don't take your Holy Spirit away from me. Return the joy of your salvation to me and sustain me with a willing spirit. Then I will teach wrongdoers your ways and sinners will come back to you. Deliver me from violence, God, God of my salvation, so that my tongue can sing of your righteousness. Lord, open my lips and my mouth will proclaim your praise. You don't want sacrifices. If I gave you an entirely burned offering, you wouldn't be pleased. A broken spirit is my sacrifice, God. You won't despise a heart, God, that is broken. Crushed.
I wonder if my life could really
second scripture reading is taken from Joel, and I will be reading selected verses from chapter 2. Blow the horn in Zion, give a shout on my holy mountain. Let all the people of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming. It is near, a day of darkness and no light, a day of clouds and thick darkness. Like blackness spread out upon the mountains, a great and powerful army comes, unlike any that has ever come before them or will come after them in centuries ahead. Yet even now, says the Lord, return to me with all your hearts, with fasting, with weeping, and with sorrow. Tear your hearts and not your clothing. Return to the Lord your God, for he is merciful and compassionate, very patient, full of faithful love, and ready to forgive. So have you ever been lost before? Like that unfamiliar place, no idea where you're going, lost? I remember getting lost out in the woods when I was about 10 years old. And my family was on a summer vacation road trip through Minnesota and Wisconsin, along with my aunt and uncle and a couple cousins. And the campground we were staying at was heavily wooded and had several trails that you could explore around the campgrounds. There was a trailhead very close to our campsite, and my little brother told me that there was a shortcut to the playground. He used it frequently and always beat me to the best swing. My cousin and I decided to use that shortcut, but we didn't realize that there were multiple paths that you could take. We weren't really paying attention to where we were going as we chatted, as we walked. And we just assumed that we would end up at the playground before my brother, of course. But after a while, we realized that we should have been at that park already. But when we tried to retrace our steps, we found that we had lost the trail altogether. Our hearts sank as we realized that we were lost, and that nobody even knew where to look for us. Trying to orient ourselves with our surroundings, we guessed which direction we should try, and we looked for signs of a path. And of course, not planning to be gone for very long, I mean, after all, we were just running over to the park, neither one of us had any supplies with us, like food or water. And we knew we were in trouble. And I'm not sure if it was our thirst or the thought of what our parents were gonna do to us when they found us. Fortunately, we stumbled upon a nicely groomed trail. In fact, it was much nicer than the dirt footpath we had originally started on. And we followed that trail for a couple hours until it finally met up with a road. And in joyful amazement, we even discovered a road sign that pointed to our campground. Although, unfortunately, we were still more than a few miles away. As we walked along that road, it started to get dark and our anxiety grew. And not just because we were in an unfamiliar place that was growing in darkness, but we had convinced ourselves that our parents were going to be furious with us for wandering off. And we didn't want to face their wrath or maybe even their disappointment. So have you ever done that before? Have you ever decided how somebody else would feel or react without actually giving them a chance to decide for themselves? While our worried parents may have been angry that we wandered off, well, they certainly welcomed us back with open arms. So why would we expect anything different from our Heavenly Father? When we stray from the path, when we lose our way, when we find ourselves in the dark wood of life, why don't we expect God to welcome us back with open arms? We think that we can decide for God. We put qualifiers on our situations and judge ourselves as unworthy of God's love and forgiveness. And when we feel far away from God, we forget that we are the ones who created the distance. No matter how lost we get or how far we push ourselves away from God, God is always right there, calling us to Him, welcoming us with open arms. Now, recently, I've seen memes circulating on social media that say things like, 2020 was the lentiest Lent we've ever lented. The COVID-19 pandemic descended upon us last year at the beginning of Lent, and for some, it feels like Lent never ended. The 40 days of Lent are representative of Jesus' time spent in the wilderness, and as I watch the news or read the newspaper, as I scroll through Facebook, as I listen to your stories, I can't help but wonder if maybe some of us have gotten lost out in the wilderness. Maybe you lost your way, or you were tempted off the path. Maybe you just feel stuck, not moving backwards, but not moving forward either. Maybe you just sat down in the middle of the woods, waiting for someone else to find you. Or maybe you don't feel worthy to continue the journey at all. But our scripture today showed us, yet even now, says the Lord, return to me with all your heart. Return to me with all your heart. It's time to come back to the campsite, to come home where God is waiting with open arms. And it's time to start making intentional choices to find your way. Many people follow the tradition of giving something up during Lent, choosing to look at this season as a time of sacrifice or self-denial. But in this strange year, when it's felt like much has already been taken away from us already, I would encourage you to instead add something new. Instead of giving something up, create a new habit, one that brings you closer to God. Instead of giving up chocolate or caffeine, start an intentional routine of prayer and scripture. Listen to a Christian podcast or grab a book that has a Christ-centered theme. Start a Bible study on Zoom, or I don't know, just grab some time with your friends where you talk about your faith. Fill yourself with positive things that point you to Christ. And if you still feel that you need to give up something for Lent, that's okay. But just make sure that you are replacing that with something good. Something that points you to Christ and will lead you closer to God on your Lenten journey. During times like this, it can feel that you are on this journey alone. But I want you to remember that we are all on this journey together, whether we are gathering in person or we are online, whether we are near or far, we are still connected and we are still on this journey together. And remember that God is always there, keeping the campfire going. Would you pray with me? God, we remember through Ash Wednesday how prone we are to get lost, and through Lent, how you are always calling us home. Yet for many of us, it's hard to return home to someone that we don't know, that we've forgotten, or that we maybe even fear. So remind us once again, or even for the first time, remind us of the sound of your voice. Here is the voice you're to return to, said your prophet Joel to the Israelites. The Lord is merciful and compassionate, very patient, full of faithful love, and ready to forgive. So as we journey, especially when it is hard, remind us who you are, Lord. And with Jesus as our guide, we are ready to stop going our own way, to turn around and to come home. Amen. In the 6th century, the church began a ritual at the beginning of the Lenten season of imposing ashes made of the previous year's Palm Sunday palm branches as a sign of the journey towards death that we are all on. We are reminded that God created us from dust, and to dust we shall return. But we do this remembering that death is not the last word. Our lives are actually full of the juxtaposition of the palm parade, when people gathered around Jesus and proclaimed justice in the face of oppression. And even though this parade was leading Jesus toward his death, we know the triumphal rest of the story. It is with this confidence that we move through our lives amidst the complexity of joy and sorrow. And tonight, as we begin our Lenten journey together, we remember this gift of death, for it contains within it the gift of life beyond death. And those who were gathered in person took with them one of these little burlap pieces of cloth that have the sign of the cross on it with ashes already put on it. And if you're joining us online and you would like one of these as well, I would encourage you either to stop by the church, or if you're far away, just reach out to the church office and we'll make sure that we can get one of these reminders to you if you would like this today. You can choose to wear this cross as a reminder throughout Lent, or perhaps you just want to keep it in your pocket, or you want to display it on your bathroom mirror or on your nightstand. Just make sure that you have it somewhere that you can access it frequently, either visually or just that texture in your pocket, just knowing that God is with you always, wherever you go. So every time you look at that cross of ashes, remember Christ's sacrifice for you, and remember that you are dust, and to dust you shall return, and that God makes beautiful things out of the dust. And now, as we end our time together, would you please accept this blessing? May the Spirit of the living God go before you to show you the way, go above you to watch over you, go behind you to push you into the places you may not necessarily go yourself, go beneath you to uphold you and uplift you, and go beside you to be your strong and constant companion, and dwell within you to remind you that you are surely not alone, and that you are loved, loved beyond your wildest imagination. And may the fire of God's blessing burn brightly upon you and within you, now and always. Amen. Thank you so much for joining me in this moment of worship.